If the sun exploded, what would happen to life on Earth, and would we even see it coming? Let's get technical. In a galaxy the size of the Milky Way, every 50 to 100 years or so, one of the billions of stars gravitationally bound within explodes, outshining all the other stars in the galaxy put together for weeks to months. These supernovae are among the most energetic events in the entire universe. We've observed a few of these over the centuries, but never one in our cosmic backyard. Though our sun will change during its lifetime in that it will expand so much into a red giant that it will vaporize all the inner planets and will be consumed with fire, our sun just isn't heavy enough to go supernova. To go supernova, our sun would need 10 to 100 times the mass it has now. But Dr. Ethan Siegel, astrophysicist and Zangief impersonator who we've worked with before on this show, had an interesting thought experiment that I'd like to share with you. What if our relatively tiny sun did go supernova? What would happen to us? First, how does a star die? At the end of a massive star's life, the hydrogen and helium it was using to fuel fusion starts to run out, and so the star starts to burn less efficient and heavier elements in its fusion processes, like carbon, neon, and oxygen. Eventually, as elements get heavier and heavier in this process, iron starts to build up in the star's core, and when this happens, a star's fate is sealed. This iron core is inert. The fusion of iron doesn't yield any additional energy, so when this starts to happen, there's a huge loss in thermal pressure fighting the gravity that's trying to collapse the star. And so, about a day after the star starts burning silicon, the core collapses and the outer shells race inwards towards the iron core at 23% the speed of light and then rebound off of the core, producing a shockwave that erupts from the surface of the star a few hours later because the star is so big and produces the equivalent of 30 years worth of an entire galaxy's light. If this happened with our sun, we wouldn't see it coming, literally. In terms of distance, the sun is a little over 8 light minutes away from Earth, and the fastest anything can travel, including information, is the speed of light. And so any information we get about the sun, where it is, what it's doing, what it looks like, is always 8 minutes in the past. If the sun exploded and was gonna bathe us in a galaxy's worth of light, we wouldn't know about it until basically the moment it happened. The sun would look normal in the sky one moment, and then the next but now we have to get technical. Would our sun going supernova actually destroy us, and what would be the true mechanism of our demise if it did? There are two common sense ways a supernova could erase us. First, you think that just the photons, the light brighter than whole galaxies, would be enough to fry us. It's slow because this is actually to scale here. Second, you might think that the blast wave from a supernova, the star's material moving outwards from it at many percent the speed of light, would be enough to just destroy an entire planet. And in both of these cases, you'd be right. Either one of these apocalypses would immediately sterilize the side of the Earth facing the sun when the material or the light got there, and then the other side of the Earth would die shortly thereafter. However, neither of these apocalypses would be what gets us first. No, that galactic Grim Reaper is completely invisible. If our sun went supernova, what we'd have to worry about most is something that's harmlessly passing through you right now. As the hydrogen and helium that powers the sun's fusion burns away, an immense amount of heat, light, and neutrinos are created. Neutrinos are a rather bizarre particle that are electrically neutral and so small, physicists long thought that they had no mass at all. Neutrinos are famous for only acting through gravity and the nuclear weak force, meaning that they hardly interact with matter at all. To put this weak interaction into perspective, the common figure that you'll find in physics textbooks is that on average, thanks to the neutrino flux from the sun, about 70 trillion neutrinos are passing through the surface of your hand right now and you feel nothing. Neutrinos are so weakly interacting, in fact, that something has to be truly dummy thick in volume before a neutrino will hit it on average. But how dummy thick, you say? That requires some math. No, I'm not gonna apologize for saying it. It's what the kids say on Twitter and Tinder? Consider a neutrino, not to scale. If this particle is going to hit something, then its effective collision area is gonna be a function of its diameter. This area for a neutrino, which took physicists a long time to come up with, is indescribably small. So you can imagine that it would take a lot of even very, very dense material to stop one. Let's try a textbook example. We are going to use this equation to estimate how far on average a neutrino can travel through a material before bumping into one of that material's particles. Sigma here will be our effective cross-sectional area for our neutrino. Rho here will be the density of the material we're traveling through. We're going to use the density of lead, one of the densest materials, and U here is just basically a conversion factor so that all of these numbers work out. All right, how far will a neutrino travel in lead before interacting with a particle of that lead? We have all the numbers, so why don't you tell me? Pop quiz! The answer is 15 quadrillion meters. Did you get it? This is over a light year and a half of lead. We are talking about a block of metal that a neutrino could travel all the way through that is 1,000 times wider than our solar system. Now that's dummy thick. The fact that matter is basically transparent to neutrinos makes them very difficult to detect. A small detector might not ever pick up a neutrino despite the fact that trillions upon trillions of neutrinos are passing through it at every moment. Scientists get around this problem by scaling everything up and building absolutely mammoth machines. For example, this is the largest neutrino detector in the world, the Ice Cube Neutrino Observatory. It's located in the South Pole and uses all the pristine ice there as the dense material for the neutrinos to interact with. And it uses a lot of ice. To maximize its detection chances, this multi-million dollar apparatus places sensors throughout 1 cubic kilometer of ice. That's nearly a gigaton worth of ice. Now, we keep saying that neutrinos, thanks to the sun, are passing through everything all the time. And so you might be thinking to yourself now, well, if neutrinos interacted with matter more and had more energy, we'd be in a lot of trouble. Well, guess what happens during a supernova? It wouldn't be the light or the blast wave from a supernova that got us. Neutrinos would erase all life on Earth before we even knew it. Remember how a giant star dies? The core collapses, material falls inwards, rebounds off of the core, creates a shockwave, and blows everything apart. Well, before any of that blowing apart even happens, before the star explodes, an unbelievable number of neutrons are created right when the star collapses. In just 10 seconds after a star's core collapses, a maelstrom of 10 octodecillion neutrinos are created and pass through the star like it wasn't even there. Now, it's kind of counterintuitive to where we think an explosion's energy is, but these neutrinos actually carry 99% of a supernova's potential. How much energy? 100 tredecillion joules. I've never even said that word before. And as Dr. Ethan Siegel points out, this kind of energy is like if you threw an antimatter bomb the size of Jupiter at Jupiter.
Note to self, looking at Jupa Jupe, antimatter bombs.
Oh, sorry, When the sun explodes in our thought experiment, all these neutrinos are gonna race across space, traveling at more or less the speed of light, and will hit the Earth about 8 minutes later. And when they get there, they are not gonna just pass through harmlessly like neutrinos usually do, because three things are now very different. Recall our numbers for, on average, how many neutrinos are passing through the surface of your hand thanks to the sun and their average impact area. Here is their energy when they're produced from the sun. Now, during a supernova, all of these numbers change for the worse. The neutrino flux from the sun would increase by 10 quadrillion times. Their average impact area would increase by a factor of 10,000, and their energy would go up by 25 times. Now these neutrinos have a lot more energy, they are larger, more likely to interact, and there's a lot more of them. And you wouldn't need a cubic kilometer of ice to feel this. The volume of your body is more than enough. To finally answer our question, I have come up with a perfectly named equation, if I do say so myself, which I do. I present to you the Novae equation. N is our nucleon density for the material we're traveling through. Phi here is the neutrino flux from the source, like a supernova. V is the volume in question, like your human volume. Sigma, remember, is our neutrino impact area. And E is the average energy per neutrino particle. This equation should be able to tell us how much energy per second is deposited into a human volume during a supernova. It's really, really specific, but come on, what did you expect from me? Come on. If the sun exploded, before it actually exploded, every human being on Earth would be mercilessly subjected to 50,000 watts of neutrino power, 50,000 joules every second. This equates to a lethal dose of radiation for every person in less than a 20th of a second. This neutrino flux would go on to vaporize everything on the planet and basically everything on all of the planets in the solar system hours before any of the light from the sun's supernova even got to any of those planets. And when it got there, it would find an Earth already scorched clean. This is a silent apocalypse. So, if the sun exploded in a supernova, it wouldn't be the explosion itself that erased the solar system. It would be the ghostly neutrino. And what's really scary about these ghosts is that there's nowhere to hide from them. No realistic amount of shielding would save you. You couldn't even put an entire planet between you and the sun to protect yourself from these particles. Again, the sun is not gonna go out this way, but if it did, it would take us all with it. Not with a bang, but with a weakly interacting whimper. Because science. I just want to say thank you to Dr. Ethan Siegel's article on this topic, which I read on his Starts With a Bang blog on Forbes, and it was very informative. A lot of the information is from the same place, so I suggest you go and follow him. He's fascinating, and read all this stuff. He's really good at writing. Also, if the sun were to actually go supernova, it wouldn't, like, give us no warning at all. There's something called the supernova early warning system that we have set up across the planet, snooze, and you can monitor different stars and their outputs, their luminosity, what they're doing to kind of give you some kind of early warning so it wouldn't come out of nowhere. But even if we did detect it early, I mean, there's not a whole lot you can do.